speaker today discusses his topic with us and his points occur to you, please feel free to write them down, and they will be collected at the end of the speech, and I will be asking him questions then from the audience. You're also welcome, of course, to go to the microphones. Our first question, as usual, will be posed to the speaker by our board host, who is today Bill Wessinger. Oregon is one of several states that are seeking to be designated as the site of the superconducting super collider. It is a $4.4 billion research facility. It will be the next generation of what is popularly known as an atom smasher, devices that are helping scientists learn more and more about the nature of the atom and its component parts. This facility will have enormous importance in the future development of nuclear research, and also enormous importance to the economy and the culture of whatever state is lucky enough to get the siting for the facility. Oregon has had, during the past few months, a five-person task force appointed by the governor, chaired by Harry Lonsdale of Bend. They have been working very hard with the assistance of an awful lot of people, many of you seated here today, from education and science and industry and government, to try to put together Oregon's application to be the site of this facility. All of us should keep our fingers crossed. It's a very important decision that will be made in the next few months, and we hope that Oregon will remain in the running until the end. Our speaker today is eminently qualified to discuss this project with us, to discuss its potential impact on our economy, and to discuss more broadly the impact and the significance of scientific research in general for the economy of a state and a region. Dr. Hermann Grunder is one of the world's leading experts in accelerator physics. He is a native of Switzerland, obtained his PhD from the University of Basel. For several years, he was deputy director of the Lawrence Berkeley Laboratory in California, and his accomplishments there led to his appointment in May of 1985 to be the director of the Continuous Electron Beam Accelerator Facility, now under construction in Newport News, Virginia. He's been involved in planning for the superconducting supercollider just about from its inception, and we're delighted to have him with us today to discuss the significance of this facility and scientific research in general for our state. Please welcome Dr. Hermann Grunder.
Mr. Chairman, distinguished members, ladies and gentlemen, it is a great honor for me to be here today. And it is a great opportunity for me. I have a captive audience of unmatched sophistication and diversity, and I really have an opportunity to persuade you of my convictions. Having Reverend Jesse Jackson follow me next week, at least I will give him a run for his money. I am only the most recent traveler from the Commonwealth of Virginia to stop here where the Willamette River meets the Columbia. 182 years ago, an expedition led by two Virginians, Lewis and Clark, stopped here too. They came at the direction of one of our most important Virginians, President Thomas Jefferson. I come to check on the progress. Your progress is clear and commendable, and it's most remarkable in its balance. The frontier you found has been replaced by growth in agriculture, natural resource management, education, industry, and trade, all with the ideal long-term goal of as little damage to the environment as possible. I come to point out to you that there is a new frontier before you, a frontier you can reach by science and technology, and by effective transfer of that technology to industry. I want to talk to you about this vision, about the foresight and imagination that the leaders of a community need to have to achieve excellence in science and technology and thereby invest in their future. In such a community, the creative energy of both pure and applied basic research help to stimulate the kind of innovative technology that will lead to economic competitiveness. Now, that was a mouthful, but that's the party line of our president, and therefore, there it is. Such communities are built by people who truly see how science and technology advance and how the society can benefit from it who supports it. You better than anybody know the immense potential of the state of Oregon. The pre-existing qualities of the state itself are perfect to attract the kind of people which are necessary. Have you ever heard of a scientist, a businessman, or an engineer who doesn't like scenic beauty, perfect weather, moderated now and then by a bit of rain, and a pervasive respect for the environment? Situated at the Pacific Rim, you are in an ideal position to achieve a future that includes strong, diverse enterprises in science and technology. And if the Pacific is to replace the Atlantic as one of the busiest oceans for trade and as a key in geopolitics, you have all the more reason to look forward to that future. But to work for that future and its technical advances will require vision. So it's not atoms or politics or technical details you need to hear about. Instead, my role here today is to describe the fundamental elements which lead to a region of excellence in science and technology, and to try to illuminate the subtle but existing interconnections among these elements. Most importantly, my task is to emphasize that part that looks far into the future. Did you follow so far? Very good. Very well then. What are the fundamental requirements of a community of excellence in science and technology? There are four, and they are needed in combination. Firstly, you need a commitment to basic research led by top-notch research universities, and which is often done at the most modern national facilities. You need industrial participation, both in pure and applied research. You need venture capital to get new industries going. And you need a supportive local infrastructure. These four elements make up the critical mass. They include strong ties to the basic research being done worldwide, and the federal support which enhances the research done at your universities. A federal research facility is, of course, an important part to the kind of communities we are discussing. And hence, the superconducting supercollider, quite a mouthful, exemplifies a national research facility which would catalyze such a community's scientific and technological activities. However, it is easier with such an infusion of money. It's nice to point to it, but it is not a go, no-go situation. Let me review these fundamental components one by one. I must start first and most important with basic research. And this is not only parochial. This is not only why I like to do it. I think it has a function. I think it is important. It gives us knowledge. And when we accumulate knowledge over a long period of time, we can develop technologies. We can use that research, develop technologies, and transfer those technologies to industry, which then, in their part, can use it to drive the production of marketable goods. Basic research is not and gives not immediate gratification in the marketplace. It is not picking up a place of gold. It is more like planting an orchard or reforesting the Tillamook berm. It is a long-term investment. It will pay off eventually. Let me make an example. In the 19th century, Faraday and then Maxwell and later Hertz laid the groundwork for the invention of the radio. They were merely curious about nature. They wanted to learn more about it. They were studying basic electrodynamics. They were studying how nature behaves. They weren't studying communications over long distances. And yet, they were preparing the way for Marconi to invent the radio without even knowing it. It's the same nowadays. Researchers don't know what the long-term benefit of the research will be. They are just curious. They do it because it is an intellectual challenge and it is an intellectual adventure. They would like to know how a mountain is formed, how hereditary traits get transmitted, or what forces guide the behavior of quarks as the ultimate building blocks of nature. Researchers aren't really trying to change the world. And yet, in understanding nature and using its secrets, they do change the world, creating the scientific base for undiscovered technologies yet is clearly the most obvious reason for the nation to support basic research. It is good business. It pays off. Let me give you a dramatic example. The discovery of the electron and parts of the atomic nucleus, namely the proton and the neutron, accomplished just within the last 90 years, are responsible for 1/3 of our gross national product today. But please note, when I said just 90 years, this is more than most of us are here on Earth, it's a long time. The cause and effect relationship between science and useful, marketable products takes decades. And more important, it's almost indirect, or almost indirect, and therefore hard to predict, hard to trace. And yet, equally important, the motivation is different. The researcher wants to do it because it is an intellectual adventure, because it is an intellectual challenge. And we know how the good old prophet and good old American greed helps in the marketplace. Two different motivations, both essential to get the science to the science base, to the technology, to the product. The environment that nurtures and sustains pure science is the research university system, industrial laboratories, and national laboratories. Oregon has an established system of research universities and institutions of research and education to provide that nurturing environment. The vitality of their basic research program is demonstrated by the funding and research center development currently underway. For example, the University of Oregon at Eugene is embarked upon a $45 million rebuilding and renovation of their research facilities. At Corvallis, Oregon State University, is a pace setter, 10th among the national land-grant university in obtaining federal funds in a competitive way. In addition, Oregon has a base of smaller colleges that are ranked nationally among the best. We look towards the universities to take the lead in basic research and to continue the tradition of pursuing excellence in selected, very well-defined fields. In particular, we look to the universities to attract the best young minds to that pursuit. And then, ladies and gentlemen, when we have the best young minds, we need to preserve them for the local economy, or at least trade with them. In summarizing, the work of research universities and our national research programs, we recognize that basic research, A, perpetuates the age-old search for knowledge, continually revitalizes education in a fundamental way, and by doing these things, ensures progress towards the vital technological future, to the vital technologies for the future. In search for knowledge, the search for knowledge predates all the other endeavors and underlies most advances in civilization. The application of vital energies in search for this knowledge is a mark of a vigorous and healthy forward-looking society. It becomes part of our culture. It would seem that we must be doing well in this country in our search for knowledge, given our substantial expenditures in this field. But there is a flaw in our support, a defect in priorities and balance. And allow me, ladies and gentlemen, to address it for a short moment. On the one hand, we are ready and eager to support such a glorious and important enterprise as the SSC. On the other hand, the basic research equipment in some of our universities is outdated and inadequate. Let me give you a small example, not in Oregon, of what happens when our efforts to sustain and nurture basic research are not well balanced. I know a young postdoc at a major university, a well-respected university. He is a geologist. Like other scientists, geologists need to have good instrumentation to get accurate data for their research. This young geologist cannot get such data at his university, and he is sending his samples to Europe. This is a problem at the fundamental level of research, the professor, the postdoc, and the graduate student. It is therefore a problem for all of us. This is an unintended issue across the land, an unintentional issue across the land. In Europe and Japan, people know that scientists need well-equipped laboratories if they are to produce the kind of science which is useful for the future technologies. Let me explain why this comes about. Research positions get created by the state. Research is strongly supported by the National Science Foundation on the way via grants. And you can see that the equipment to do the research falls quite frequently into a crack. There is real hope, however. This administration's proposed doubling the budget of the National Science Foundation over the next 5 years, and that is besides the exciting initiative of SSC, CBAF, and other projects, exceedingly good news that science at large, on the level of the graduate student and the postdoc, is alive and well. Now let me turn to the other part of the basic research equation, the role of the federal government. Some research tools need to be owned by every researcher. Some research tools can be shared on a local level, but other research tools, especially today's large ones, must be shared and provided for nationally. With the increase in sophistication of these research tools, the federal government, and sometimes even more than a larger areas in the federal government, international collaborations, are the right backing for such tools. The projects that I direct in Virginia, the continuous electron beam accelerator facility, quite a mouthful, CBAF, will cost about $250 million. It will explore nuclear matter in a new light. That is, we will be given the opportunity to understand the underlying structure of quarks and gluons, which is allegedly the fundamental building blocks of nature, how they affect the atoms and hence the universe. New knowledge about quark-based nuclear matter is certainly fundamental, certainly needs to be done on some timescale, and we need national backing for it. The SSC initiative, with $4.5 billion, stretching through a 52-mile tunnel, will be the biggest scientific instrument ever conceived. This new knowledge, which the SSC is going to create, will be in particle physics. It will be with regards to the fundamental forces of nature and of creation of the universe itself. Facilities like CBAF and the SSC represent research equipment sharing on the grandest scale. This leads to my summarizing point about pure research and the point about the pure research and education. Research is the essence of modern education. In a society that works together to support scientific advance, students at all levels can feel some of the excitement that accompanies the search for learning of new knowledge. This helps in their learning of existing knowledge. Universities and facilities for basic research provide another, less obvious educational benefit. They keep us all, luncheon speakers, business people, politicians, kids, everybody, used to advancing knowledge. We talk about it. By pumping new knowledge and new ideas into society, research institutions perpetuate the society's will and ultimately the capability to advance. Frankly, though, in the past couple of decades, we have done a poor job, we the scientists, have done a poor job of letting the public at large be part of the excitement of scientific discovery. In recent months, the excitement surrounding the new high-temperature superconductors is evident everywhere, from high school classes to civic organizations. Let's pause for a moment and see where we are. I've been trying to emphasize the importance of basic research and to remind you why, as a nation, we should sustain and nurture it. Our university-led national program of basic research sets the context. No, it is the context for scientific and high-tech prosperity. And I remind you that the transfer of science in the form of knowledge ensures progress toward future technologies. I need to mention an immediate spin-off that comes from learning how to build these large research tools. So let me now give you a pair of examples of how a national research facility such as SSC or seabath stimulates the high technology of the present and thus promotes industrial participation. Seabath is based on superconducting radio frequency technology. It is not important that you exactly understand what that is. But what is important is this is a technology which is the appropriate technology for the task at hand, and in the laboratory it has been developed. These cavities, these are pieces about that size, have to be carefully crafted. And so far, until a few months ago, this has only been done in a laboratory. But now, thanks to collaboration with industry, several companies have developed capabilities to make such cavities for seabath, and one such cavity is right in Virginia. They are now not only working on producing such cavity, they are also looking for applying this technology to other products. The second example is the 19,000 kilometers of superconducting cable that will be needed to build the SSC, the magnets of the SSC. It's clear that this will automatically send a signal and an incentive to the respective industries in this area. So it's of great interest here in Oregon that Teledyne Huajiang, the leading maker of the niobium titanium alloy needed for the superconducting magnets of the SSC, and at the same time is a source for the high purity niobium for seabath cavities. The point is that the National Research Facility not only operates at the limit of scientific knowledge, it also operates to reach its mission at the technological limit of the technologies in question. But to return now to the four fundamental elements of the community of excellence in science and technology. Besides well-supported universities, the community needs strong industrial participation. The community needs to be a good place for business to grow, engaging in pure and applied research. Free enterprise has supported such ventures since the time Thomas Edison Company hired a long-haired tinker to find out what he could dream up. If corporations have their research arm in a community, the company isn't far away. Thus, this is to speak of the quintessential central element, the participation of industry, because industry is a key to jobs and is promoting economic competitiveness. It can't come as a surprise, therefore, that industry and research universities are and must be linked. Researchers should be in contact with each other across institutional lines. Leaders and decision makers in both the university and free enterprise should talk and should understand not only each other, but also the research being done in their institution. They can do that easily because fundamental science, basic science, has no immediate practical application. Alas, but it's a fact of life, and here it becomes an advantage. The work that has been being done on high-temperature superconductors is an example of this. The university research community and the industrial community have worked together to achieve the latest advances in an admirable way. Another example is modern medical tools, which are quite frequently developed between industry and universities together. A special approach to link universities and industry as part of their overall research programs is to establish a formal organization to promote university-industry collaborations. Such collaborations in applied research are appropriate and mutually profitable. The current effort in Virginia, a state-funded center for innovative technology, may well prove to be a useful advance in integrating the processes of scientific and technological progress. It will foster interaction and stimulate creativity among researchers, engineers, and decision makers. I believe you have established exactly this sort of facilitating function in your Oregon Center for Advanced Technology Education here in Portland, and the Advanced Science and Technology Institute, co-sponsored by the University of Oregon and Oregon State University. Develop and support these organizations. They can play a vital role in promoting the information flow and forum required for the effective integration of science and technology. If industry and its labs are present in an area of scientific and high-tech vitality, hopefully there will also be venture capital. The third very important element in our equation. If you want to achieve economic competitive in a high-tech world, give venture capital a reason to be interested in your area. By venture capital, I mean not only the large established companies, but new flexible ones. Often the people running such companies come from organizations of pure research. They want to use their skills and knowledge to make money. They want to have application of their science in favor of marketable products. However, they draw on science, they are connected of what's happening on the scientific base. In doing so, they are an important part of the mixture. And finally, and I don't need to stress it, it is important that you have a supportive infrastructure. And you know what that means. The community itself needs to participate, needs to be interested, and needs to pass laws which are not unnecessarily inhibiting. It needs to provide real estate, like in your Columbia corridor. It needs particularly to watch out that real estate is available if and when the big mixture of components starts to ferment and to come to fruition. As with the other fundamental elements, you're demonstrating in Oregon that you understand the importance of the infrastructure. And so it seems you have recognized to a substantial degree everything that is necessary to achieve a productive integration of basic research and its long-term benefits. A healthy university system, industrial collaboration, financial support in the sense of venture capital, and government and community support. You Oregonians are truly pioneers. Your ancestor made an arduous journey over the long Oregon Trail to settle this rich and beautiful land. They came to work, to develop, to expand many frontiers. They came with vision and determination, and they served you well. And frontiers are still here for you today. The opportunities to discover, to create, and to improve the quality of life. Here on the western edge of the continent, you are among the growing markets, the burgeoning technologies, and the keen competition that ring the Pacific. SSC's ring would fit admirably here. In any case, you have the natural, the economic, the political, and the human resources to expand your leadership in this arena. If you pursue your heritage of vision, of reaching into new frontiers, you will then continue that expedition that began back in 1805 by Lewis and Clark. It's for you to map the new Oregon Trail. In the meanwhile, we will look from the West, we will look to the West from the old Commonwealth of Virginia to see how you pioneers are doing. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Grunder. We have time for some questions. Before I open the floor to questions and call on Bill Wessinger first, though, I want to point out two things that are on our literature table this afternoon. One is a copy of Dr. Grunder's speech, so you can pick up a copy if you'd like to have it. Secondly, a little brochure put out by our Oregon Superconductor Task Force describing the status of Oregon's bid and a little bit more about the proposal that our task force has put together to try to attract the super collider here. So pick one of these up from our literature table too. Bill Wessinger, you may have the first question.
Doctor, in a state that has 1% of the population and has a colossus to the south of us that's 10 times as big as we are, should there be a state policy or a community policy maybe that we try to focus on certain phases of research and not the whole gamut, or do we let people just go their own route and do whatever they want to do?
The short answer is both of the above. You are, of course, correct that any part of a great nation like the United States should not try to pursue every possible aspect of basic research. It's even a question whether the nation as a whole can do that. In fact, it can. So even the more for Oregon to restrict itself to certain important aspects is very significant. On the other hand, the nature of research is such that you will have a hard time with direct measures. So what you need to do is to make certain areas of research more readily available than others, and there, with that mechanism, you will direct it. People who don't want to pursue that will go to another place, and people who'd like to pursue that will come to you.
If you have questions, I invite you to come to the microphone in the center of the room, or to write them if you prefer, and to give them to Mark or Susan, and they will bring them up to the podium. There were some questions submitted before our meeting today from some of our members. One certainly relates to what you've said already, Doctor, but maybe you can expand on it a little bit. When Oregon has had such tremendous cutbacks in its education budgets, and there is a somewhat negative image, perhaps, around the country of Oregon's educational environment, and we face such severe competition from something like the consortium of universities in the southeastern states that support your facility in Newport News, is there really any realistic chance that Oregon, with its status in higher education, has a chance for the SSC?
That's an easy question, in the sense, of course. The circumstances of funding of the SSC are such that the federal government will go on out of its way, correctly so, because it is of a national priority, to see to it that the sum total of the opportunities reaching from geology to educational opportunities to as mundane things electric power be evaluated. So the education is one aspect of it. Furthermore, of course, you have here an opportunity to make to yourself and to the rest of the nation commitments of where you want to go, mostly anyway, and therefore that much more eagerly if there's a nice prize to be had.
Professor Pacific Northwest at the moment does have a power surplus, Doctor, but in years when it doesn't, can you say more about the power requirements of this facility, and how does Oregon rate compared to Virginia in power accessibility?
I cannot answer the specific rates. I do not know them. But the power consumption is of the variety of a power, installed power of 200 megawatts, 250 megawatts, and a power usage of something like 80 to 120 megawatt hours per hour. So you can see that's quite a few million dollars that no matter what price you put for the electric power. So it's clear, this is an important factor. And if the scant information I have on the power rates, it's very hard to beat the Northwest.
Fred Haler, a member. I need a little education. I've done some reading about the superconductor, but I'd like to know precisely what it is, point one. Secondly, what is potential? I hear there's great potential in the future. And how soon can we reach that potential?
Wonderful. Give me 5 seconds, because you want it in less than 3 hours. And it's a wonderful question, of course. Let me start this way. There is an irony in nature, the following irony, that the smaller the object you want to look at, the larger the tool. Does that make sense? Okay. I give you numbers. With the electron microscope, you can look and perceive the size of an atom. With a superconducting supercollider, you can look at things which are very, very, very much smaller than the diameter of an atom. Hence, the size is enormous. So, that's the size. Now, what does it do? It is a type of microscope to study the most fundamental building blocks of nature. How do you do that? How can you visualize such a microscope? By letting the smallest pieces of matter you can imagine collide with each other, and in that collision take out the information. Why does that work? It works because the energy density, the energy per unit volume, becomes the relevant parameter in this interaction. Does that make sense? I'm trying to look at you. Okay. No, I think I should stop with the explanation. So it is a basic research tool at the very frontier or exceeding frontier of our knowledge about the smallest things in matter or the highest energy densities we can imagine. It is getting close to what we call in energy density, to what we call the Big Bang, the creation of the universe. It's in the terminology of that evolution, the universe, it is a few microseconds after the Big Bang. It's the energy density. What will it do for us? In the first go-round, it will create new knowledge. And you will have to wait. Your great-grandchildren will use that knowledge to develop technologies you and I can't even dream of. In our lifetime, to get this instrument built, we will have to develop technologies which have their own fascination and their own utility and can be used to spin off other products useful in the marketplace. Will you let me out of the question now? No, he won't. What is it I haven't answered to your satisfaction? I need guidance where to continue, if at all.
If you'd like to amplify, you may.
I hate to tell you, but you didn't answer my question.
Okay.
I asked about superconductors, not the superconductor collider.
Forgive me. You should have interrupted
me. That's all right.
Much
go to the next question. It's okay.
I'm sorry. I simply misunderstood. The question is, what are superconductors? What will they do for us? Is that correct? Yes. There is, in certain materials, there is a characteristic at generally a very low temperature. The characteristic that the material in question loses any resistance to electric current. Okay? So you can transport electricity with no loss. This phenomenon has been discovered in 1911 by Kamerling Onnes in Van der Waals laboratory in the Netherlands. At that time, the discovery was made on mercury. Later on, niobium and niobium alloys and lead, a number of metals are superconductors. Until very recently, the temperature needed was very close to the absolute zero. That is something like, can somebody help me? Minus 270 degrees centigrade, but you want it in Fahrenheit, and I'll do it for you in a moment. Now, very recently, rare earth copper oxide materials, ceramic, has been demonstrated to be superconducting at relatively high temperature to the absolute zero. Still pretty cold, the temperature of liquid nitrogen. Okay. Now, if we can make these ceramics into wires and chips and all sorts of goodies, which we eventually certainly will be able to do, that will do quite a bit for you. It will transport your electricity cheaper, but before that, it will probably make your computers faster. It will have a number of other very interesting applications. We might even see magnetically levitated trains or other means of transportation. Did I now answer your question?
Next question.
And sorry again.
Well, I'm glad to have both of those questions answered. thank you, Doctor. A question about Virginia again and your facility there, the Continuous Electron Beam Accelerator facility. What did Virginia do, if anything, to compete or try to attract CBAF to Newport News?
That is a very relevant, very interesting question. Virginia, particularly under the leadership of Governor Chuck Robb, put together an association of universities, SURA, Southeastern Universities Research Association, 35 universities. The state of Virginia sponsored 9 what are called CBAF, distinguished CBAF professorships. Thank you, Dana. Furthermore, the 35 university sponsored some 25 professorships throughout the Southeast. And then the Virginia, the pay for these and the pay and a little bit around it is donated by the state of Virginia in the foreseeable future for the 9 positions.
One last question, Dr. Grunder. How do we compare, and I assume this question means maybe the United States or perhaps Oregon, how do we compare with other countries in these criteria that you've mentioned in basic research in general?
There's not a simple answer, yes or no. One has to make a few statements. In expenditure per capita, the United States lags in basic research. If you fold in lags compared to Europe or Japan, if you fold in the military R&D, we are leading, it's very clear. However, it's a bit hard to assess what you call basic in the military R&D, you know, the 6-1, 6-2 money. Fine. The environment of research has been excellent to outstanding in the United States. As you know, in the late 50s was a real brain drain from Europe to the United States, and indeed the 60s were absolute heydays. It was a wonderful world here in the United States with respect to research. During the 70s, particularly after 1974 recession, we sort of had a decade of decline. And it is recently now these initiatives in form of major research equipment, CBAF, SSC, as well as the support through the National Science Foundation of the universities, which are clearly turning around. And in fact, over the last few years, you can see at the average and clear going back, the direction of going back of the level of research we had in the late 60s, early 70s. We aren't quite there yet. That's a national decision to what extent you should be there, you know. The spirit, the teamwork, the exchange of information is wonderful in the United States. We need to get a little more organized. And we need to share with the general public the excitement, the wonderful things which really happen.
Thank you very much, Dr. Grunder. We appreciate very much that you're taking the time to come out and increase our awareness and understanding of this project and of this the importance of R&D development in general. Thank you for coming. We are adjourned.